Hello everyone, this is Direwolf 20, and welcome to episode 6 of Direwolf 20's Let's Play Series Season 6. Oh, cool. I am very excited to finally get my hands on a hammer. I'm just digging through my inventory here to decide what I might want to build the hammer out of. Ooh, I've got some obsidian. Yeah, I'll take some of that. That might not be a terrible idea. Let's go outside and see what kind of trouble we can get into. So as promised, I smelted away a bunch of cobalt, 24 ingots worth, between last episode and this one. And I also came over and made myself the items I'm going to need here, like a hammerhead cast, some large plate casts, and the tough rod cast. Okay, so those are the things that we need to get a hammer made. Okay, so let's get this guy going, shall we? Absolutely. Let's get our hammerhead cast first. That'll be good. So remember, that's going to pour out 8 ingots worth of molten cobalt. So that's why it takes a little bit longer to pour out. It's got to pour out 8 ingots instead of 1. But we've got our first hammerhead cast. And then, as you recall, we're going to need, per the hammer, a hammerhead and 2 plates. Okay. Looks pretty good. So that's the hammerhead, 1. Or the plate, that is, 1. And I get a second plate. And then I decided for my tool rod, I'm going to go with the tough obsidian one. That should be good. Let's see. Material cost 3. Oh, you know what? That's because I don't want to do this. I want to do... Must have made a tough... There it is. Tough rod pattern. There we go. Obsidian tough rod. Obsidian's good to use because, remember, it basically adds like an unbreaking type of effect to your tool. So it's just less likely to break. Should be good. All right. So cobalt, remember, I'm using because it's the fastest mining speed. There we go. Obsidian tough rod. Oh, yeah. Mining speed 11. Mining level cobalt. 3 modifiers remaining. We're going to call it the dire hammer. Awesome. Look at that. Achievement get pro tinkerer. That's right. I'm a pro tinkerer. Don't you forget it. Let's go downstairs and see what this bad boy can do. This hammer is awesome. I'm just going to put it that way. So let's say I wanted to mine out this area. Boom. Look at that. 3x3 square of mining. Very rapidly goes through. And that's with default unmodified stuff. If I wanted to come up here and get some, I don't know, some redstone perhaps? Yeah. We're going to boost the speed on this thing almost to max. Okay? So let's make that happen. I'm just getting myself a ton of redstone. What I'm going to do is put as much redstone modifier on here as I can, because I've got a surplus of redstone at the moment, and, you know, nothing else too exciting to use it on. Let's do it. Got the dire hammer here, ready to go, and we're going to boost it. So the only thing to remember here is that once you get up to that 45 out of 50, you have to do individual pieces of redstone at a time to get past that level 50 mark, and then you can do the stacks of redstone again, the blocks. Cool. There we go. Or you can do redstone and blocks of redstone both at a time to get 10 at a time, and that's going to work out even better for you. Look at that. All right, so the tool can't be modified anymore. We don't have any modifiers remaining. We used all 3 of them on redstone. But look at the mining speed now. 23. That's right. We've got a mining speed of 23. So let's see what that's going to do with the hammer. So the hammer does mine a little bit slower than a pickaxe will, simply because it's mining 3x3. But look at that. We are carving through the landscape now. Oh, I love it. Yes. Nice. That is awesome. But I'm probably not going to stop there. I can't help myself. I need more of these awesome tools. The next one I want to get is going to be even more useful, I think, than the hammer. Well... All right, maybe not more useful than the hammer, but pretty darn useful. How about I get a couple components here and decide what I want to make it out of, and then I'll be right back. All right, guys, I think I've got everything I need to make the following awesome items. Let's go over here and get some more large plates, because I'm going to need 2 large plates and 1 of each of these guys. The excavator, which is something I'm making, and I decided to make this stuff out of iron, mostly because I don't need to go nuts with the mining speed. It's something that I don't need to be super duper fast. I mean, maybe if I get a lot more cobalt, I'll be able to manage this at some point, but eh. That's all right. I'm not super worried about it being super fast or something like that. So, you know, for now, iron is a decent one. You know, it's just like a good middle of the road material. And just because these tools are awesome, I wanted to make sure I had them. All right. So we're going to get two of these things. And we can automate the smeltery, and down the line, we probably will do something along those lines, definitely. There we go, that's one. We're going to get the second. And while that's happening, I need to get myself a couple tough bindings. And we're going to make that out of netherrack. So one, two. You know, like I said, I'm not really going nuts on this. So I'm just going to go with basic netherrack also for the tool rod. I wanted to be really fancy, I could do something better, but you know what? It's just not necessary right now. All right, so netherrack binding, netherrack tough binding, and there, and then the excavator head, Dire Vader. And then I also want to get the lumber axe or the battle axe? The lumber axe, yeah. The lumber axe is the one that we want to get because this one can knock down entire trees. It's really going to help me out in the very near future. Except I don't put the plates in there. I put these things in there. There we go. Nice. Lumber axe. Dire axe. Cool. So the Dire Vader or the excavator works just like the hammer that we got. Okay. What it's going to do is whatever face of the block you click on, like this one, it's going to mine 3x3 in that area. Okay. So if you click on the, you know, face down like that, it's going to mine the top blocks. If you click in this face like that, it'll mine that. The hammer works the same way. Now the dire axe is even more awesome. Check this out. Dun 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 dun. See you, trees. Nice knowing you. This is really going to help me actually clear out a bit of this area because I would like to build a house up here, but I just have lots and lots of landscaping to do. Basically, I need to clear out a bunch of trees and I need to, you know, get rid of a bunch of stuff. So I'm thinking this is going to help quite a bit. This is cool. Yeah. This axe is really going to, you know, save time for me. That is so awesome. Yeah, we're definitely going to have a nicer time with this. So pretty soon here, we're going to be able to start building a house, but, you know, we'll see. There's so much stuff I want to get done, so many things I want to try out and do. Pretty crazy. Oh, yeah. See? Now I have plenty of wood. Awesome. Okay, so one thing we can do with this, too, I want to check this out. Yeah, the sawmill works. I should make a sawmill at some point if I really wanted to go crazy with it. Eh, we'll get there. For now, I've done a pretty nice job of clearing out some of the terrain right around my base. Nice. All right, I'll be back in a few minutes when we're ready to move on to another step of this. I might even go mining between this segment and the next. All right, guys, we are back, and I'm just getting ready to build something pretty interesting. But first, I wanted to show you this. This here Ender Lily has completely grown up. Way to go. Breaking it will get you back your initial seed investment and an ender pearl. Awesome. So I'm going to replant that guy. They do take a long time, as you can see, to grow, but, you know, eventually it'll be really nice. And like I said, if you have end stone, they'll grow a lot quicker. All right, so I have a couple things I need to make. Shall we get started? Absolutely. Let's get ourselves a couple of gears. Okay, and I'm going to upgrade these guys both to stone gears. And then iron, and then gold. That'll do. And then I just need some dandelion yellow. And then I'm going to get myself 5 landmarks. These are all from Buildcraft. And what Buildcraft allows you to do is build things automatically and craft things automatically. I'm also, while I'm at it, going to need a crafting table and a chest. Cool. Let's see what kind of trouble we can get into with the filler. The filler from Buildcraft allows you to automatically, you know, clear out or build certain parts of the terrain. Now, I'm actually going to need a little bit more. Oh, good. There is some glass going. Awesome. All right, you can go back in here. The other thing I'm going to need, though, is clay. I'm going to need about, oh, I don't know, a dozen of them. Let's cook that up. There we go. Let that start cooking. The other thing that I'd like to have is this leadstone energy cell. Glad that it's full. It looks like my coal is actually doing a pretty good job. You can see the steam dynamos, of course, when they're not actually being used. They're just sitting there and quietly relaxing, not doing much, waiting for a need for energy. Okay. The redstone furnace is doing its thing. So I'm going to pick up my leadstone energy cell. Thank you. That will stop the redstone furnace from receiving power, by the way. So let's hook them directly up to the dynamos for now. There we go. That's better. And I'm going to get, I think I've got a few more leadstone energy cells. Conduit thingies, there we go, awesome. Let's go outside with our filler and see what kind of trouble we can get into. Once I've got a bit of brick. There we go, perfect. So the filler can do a lot of interesting and neat things. And one other thing I might want to grab while I'm here is a bit of dirt. Out we go. So I'd like to, you know, do a little bit of terraforming, if you will, clearing of the terrain, tidying up this area. We've just got all this giant mess of stuff all nearby, like hills and little, you know, areas. I kind of like when I'm building my house to have like a nice, flat, even terrain to build on. Kind of like I have over here, but, you know, larger. So let's see what we can do about it. First off, we're going to grab some landmarks. And while I'm at it, I'm going to need some redstone signaling. So I'm going to grab a lever to help me out with that. Landmarks can be used in Buildcraft to map out the terrain that you want your area to be affected in. So let's say I wanted to clear out starting here. Cool. And then if we activate a redstone signal on this thing, like that, we'll see some blue lasers shooting in all directions. That's how far and what axes this thing can affect. So I'm going to kind of go off in this direction. Let's see. Does this sound like a good spot to end up? Yeah, why not? I'm going to go find that blue laser. It should be somewhat close. There it is. Cool. There you go, buddy. Thank you. So that's going to be the Terminator on that end of the line. And then we're going to go forward quite a bit, probably. Maybe, how about, I don't know, here-ish? Yeah, that sounds good. And for the filler construction that we're going to do, these three landmarks should be enough, okay? How are there sheep up in trees? Okay. I'm going to right-click on the corner end mark that connects to all the other landmarks. So this one connects to that one and that one. But that one over there only connects to this one. It doesn't connect to that one. So you want to click on the landmark that actually kind of connects to all of them. And you'll see some red laser outlines show up. To that, I'm going to place down the filler. And that'll automatically knock the landmarks down. So you can go run over and pick them both up again. So here we go. This guy got knocked off. I can go pick him up. And then the same can be said for the landmark that was over here. And this is going to allow us to manipulate all the terrain within this area. Cool, right? How do we manipulate it? Well, we have to open up the interface on the filler. And here we can set up the recipe for the filler. Now, there's a couple different things we can do. One of them is to completely clear everything within the line, okay? And that's to have all glass. But I don't really want to clear everything. I kind of want to flatten the terrain. So I'm going to go with that, with bricks on the bottom and glass on top. That's going to completely flatten the terrain. Let's see what happens. The one thing we want to do with flattening mode, though, is actually supply it some resources. Like, for in this instance, I'm going to supply it with dirt. Because if the terrain, if there's like holes in the ground below it, like this area over here, it's going to raise it up. So it actually does do a pretty good job of flattening it. It makes sure that there's dirt here, and it's going to raise it up pretty well. Okay. The final component of this is it needs energy. Now, it requires Buildcraft energy, but remember I told you guys, thermal expansion power can power Buildcraft machines, provided there's an energy pipe in between them. So if I place down my leadstone energy cell, okay, this should be able to power this machine. The only thing we need to do then is set the right side of the leadstone energy cell to output power. And ta-da, you can see some dirt being used up. Where is that being used? Well, it's filling in the area like I said it would. Once it's done finding all the little holes that it has to fill in, like that area over there, we should see it stop using the dirt. Okay, so let's see. This guy is quickly draining out stuff. Okay. And, oh, there we go. We should probably see some clearing out of terrain soon. Let's keep an eye on things. Looking around. Oh, are we getting stuff? It might actually still be filling in some areas, so don't mind. It'll be done shortly. And then once it's done filling in, like I said, it should start digging out. Okay. Let's give it a few moments here. Oh, there we go. I can see it in the distance. It's clearing out these trees. Ah, that's what it's doing. It's clipping the trees. Look at that. So it starts at the top and then breaks it, downwards. So it completely clears away the tree. And then it's going to start working on, once it's got the highest points, it's going to start clearing out some dirt as well. So I'll probably, oh, there we go. Yeah, look at that. Ta-da! Nice. Good job, filler. It's really a good way to clear out large areas of terrain. Trust me, it's so much better even than using like an excavator. So that's going to take a little bit of time because I'm not giving it a terribly large amount of power. It's still outputting at a kind of a slow pace. I wonder if I can upgrade this leadstone energy cell. Let's see, is it usable? It is. I can add Envar ingots, huh? And that'll give it even more storage and power. Awesome. Do I have 4 Envar laying around? If not, I know how to make it. Let's see, I've got 2 Envar. All right, so I'm gonna need, what is it, 2 lead and a ferrous. Let's disable the output here. Ferrous. And 2 lead. 1, 2. Then just craft these guys together. Cook up a little bit more Envar. And this is going to be an upgraded energy cell. Basically, what it does is it's able to hold more energy. So instead of 400,000, it's able to hold 2 million redstone flux energy. So it's going to have a much larger buffer. And it can send and receive more power at a time. Instead of being able to send 80, it'll be able to send 400, which will be cool. All right, so that should also increase the speed at which this whole operation runs. However, it might not have quite enough power to do it. Let's see. We're still slowly but surely burning power. Let's break this guy and upgrade him. It's dark out, and I probably shouldn't be milling around out here too much at night, but what do we get? It did. I wasn't sure if it would reset the energy cell. It didn't, so that's okay. We're going to leave this guy here, and I'm going to go start charging up this energy cell. Close that up. Wrench this thing. And right, left will be your output. Cool. So that way, all our dynamo's power will start flowing into that thing. It'll start charging itself up. Cool. Maybe I should make one more copper dynamo real quick. Why don't I do that off camera? You guys have seen enough of that, haven't you? Yeah, probably. If I have enough copper. It doesn't look like quite enough to me, actually. You know what I have to do? Copper isn't typically found down that deep into the earth, so I've been mining down at like really low Y levels, which is why I have tons of silver and gold and iron and lead even, but copper, that's usually found higher up in the ground. It's not found quite so deep. So I think I need to do a little bit of mining, but not so deep. So I'm gonna go mine, but you know, higher up, you know, kind of up near like the Y levels 50-ish area, all right? So why don't I do that, and then I'll be back to upgrade the steam dynamo area here, have another one, finish clearing out the terrain, and then I think it's time to actually live in a proper house. All right, guys, we're back. And I've got a semi-full hardened energy thingy. Not terribly full, but full enough that I can open it up on the right side, and we can see that this thing is going to burn through things a lot faster now because it's able to supply a lot more energy at once. See how much faster it's clearing stuff out? Boom. Tearing up the landscape. So definitely recommend using at least a hardened energy cell because the filler will basically operate faster depending on how much energy it's receiving at a time. So this guy's outputting, you know, 5 times the energy that the lead energy cell was. Definitely a good time. So look at this, guys. We are totally clearing out this terrain. This is awesome. The one thing that's going to be a little bit of a, well, it doesn't even look like it's going to be that bad. I thought I would have to go through and, you know, tear up a lot of the stone and replace it with dirt just to kind of make things look nice, which I'll definitely still do. It just doesn't look like there's that much to do, at least not yet. Maybe at the next level it will be. We'll see in a moment. Not bad though, right? A really nice way to clear out some of the terrain. Yeah, this was necessary. Man, I've only had a wand of equal trade. Not even close to that yet, though, unfortunately. Oh well. We'll get there, though. Don't worry. Farmcraft is definitely coming up in the near future. Alright. Now that this is done, I'm going to go through off-camera and just kind of replace most of the stone with dirt. So I'll be back in a few. Alright, guys. This doesn't look quite half bad. Alright. Let's go inside and get through this night. That Enderman just jumped all over my wheat farm. Really? You guys are starting already, aren't you? All right, guys, remember that dungeon that I found way back at the beginning of episode 1? Yeah, I'm here to get the mossy cobblestone out of it, because I'm going to put it to good use. There's nothing in here that I needed, right? Yeah, I think I got everything. I'm not going to clear the whole place out. You know what? That should be enough. Yeah, that should definitely be enough. So that's a spider one, huh? Cool. We will definitely be taking advantage of those guys pretty soon. And since I said I needed copper, I might as well mine the copper that's staring me in the face. Alright, heading back home. Alright, so the reason I went and got that mossy cobblestone is because I can use it for something very useful. Dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. We can get a ball of moss from Tinker's Construct. I'm going to put you in here. So what can we do with this thing? Well, I'm bringing it out to my tool forge because my pickaxe is getting pretty low on durability. It's almost completely broken, to be as a matter of fact about it. So you can see here we've even got a bonus to mining speed of 1.81. That's because of that stonebound trait I was telling you guys about earlier. I've only got one modifier left, and I'm going to go ahead and use it to add this guy, a ball of moss. Cool, look at that. So the ball of moss will add auto repair to my pickaxe. Cool. So if we were to look at the pickaxe now, we'll see that it's got a damage value there of 89. We can also see that it's got 169 durability. So if I hang on to it for a little bit and let some time pass, and I think the moss repairs it a little bit faster when it's exposed to sunlight. It'll still repair slowly in the dark, but you know, I think sunlight, because it's moss, helps it to grow a little bit faster. All right, let's get this guy over here and see what we're at now. 172. Cool. So we are slowly but surely repairing. The other option for repairing is to take the tool that the material's made out of and throw it in here. So if I had an extra manual ingot, which I don't at the moment, but if I did, I could add it in here in the repairing section, and it'll basically allow me to repair it straight up. So your options are to either repair it using the materials for a quick full-blown repair, or you can just hang on to it with some moss, and then you'll be all right. You'll have slow but sure repair of it. So that's why I wanted to throw on my pick, just because I knew it was getting low already. I was kind of surprised at how quickly it got down there, but I'd been doing a lot of mining, so I guess it makes sense. Probably want to throw moss on a couple other things as well. Now, the other option, of course, is to turn it into a redstone-compatible thing, so maybe I'll do that with my hammer. You know, I might turn the hammer into something that uses redstone flux energy, this stuff, instead of, throwing another auto repair on there. We'll definitely check into that a little bit later, though. I don't think at this point we need to worry about it too much. All right, so we're actually doing pretty good on materials here. I think it's about time to build a house. All right, guys, I think it's time that I built myself a proper house. And this is going to be the center of it. And I'm going to build my famous, most favorite design for a house. That's right, it's time to build myself a 9x9. There we go. A 9x9 house. I kind of started building 9x9s a while ago. Probably very early on, before I even started playing with mods, to be honest with you. And I quickly determined that the reason I make 9x9s, and I'll show you once I have this place built, but let me get a couple things real quick just to help out with this. I want to get myself a tape measure. These things are pretty easy to make. Just need a little bit of string and some yellow dye. I think I've got all that right here in this chest. So let's make a tape measure, shall we? It's real easy. Just got to get a tape measure reel and then insert it into some iron, and you've got a tape measure. This is a nice little tool that BiblioCraft gets us. And the reason I'm making this is just to help me a little bit out with my building. Obviously, I know how to build a 9x9, but you know what? This is nice to show you guys just how it works. It's real simple. Right-click on a block, and it'll place a little marker there. It'll tell you how far away you are from it as you kind of move around from it. It takes a few seconds to update what's on your screen, but you can see how many blocks you are away. And then if you want to make sure of your measurement, you can right-click on the following block, and it'll give you a measurement east to west. If we wanted to do like the opposite corner here, we could see that it's north-south 9, east-west 9, so we know it's a 9x9. You can shift-right-click to switch to absolute measurement mode, and in this mode, it'll just tell you that absolute measurement of block distance is 12 blocks away from each other. Okay? Pretty neat, right? Yeah. Shift right click to switch back to the north, south, east, west, and height mode. So 9x9. So like I was saying, I kind of started out early on determining that a 9x9 house was probably one of the best designs to go with. The reason for that is I never really liked the way torches look sitting on the floor. It's always been kind of a pet peeve of mine when people have like just torches all over the floor in this like big open room. But unfortunately, there's not much in Minecraft that really gives out much more light than a torch. At least, not until the modding community hit the scene. We definitely have some niftier gadgets these days that allow us to do a lot more, right? But as it's early game, I really don't have access to those yet, so I'm going to build out my standard 9x9 because, let's be honest, it wouldn't really be a Direwolf 20 Let's Play series if I didn't build at least one of these. And, you know, there's nobody banning me from building them on my single player. Ha ha ha. So, you can see I'm just building out. Typically, I like to also, like I said, have a good amount of light. Because one of the things was that I always found and discovered in my series is early on, I discovered this when I was recording YouTube videos, YouTube tends to be a little bit darker. So that's why I always kind of play with my brightness settings as high as possible. I want to make sure that people who are watching me play can very clearly and plainly see what I'm doing and what I'm building. Because it's not really fun if you can't see what's happening, right? Probably. So how's this look for a nice basic house? Not bad at all. Ah, yeah, the good old 9x9. You can tell I've gotten pretty good at building them. Not a pro yet, but, you know. There we go. That was cool. Zombie came out of nowhere in the middle of the day. I'm guessing there might be some kind of cave nearby. Probably off in that direction. I've seen a couple enemies coming from out of there. So I usually like to have skylights, but of course we don't want, you know, rain coming in. Ooh, you know what I could do? That's something I can show you guys. Yeah. I'll show you one of my favorite blocks from Tinker's Construct. I'm going to come over here, and I'm going to drop a bunch of glass into the smeltery. For this, I'm going to need to get rid of this guy, and I'm going to replace him with the casting basin. And you know what? Now's probably as good a time as any to show you how to automate the smeltery, because this is definitely going to be a useful trick for you guys to learn. All right, so let's put this together. I'm going to need a hopper and a chest. So let's get ourselves just a bit of iron here. Two chests. One of them are going to go towards the use of a hopper. Okay. The other thing we're going to need is a redstone signal to constantly pulse and basically, you know, emit a redstone frequency. So what options do we have? We could make ourselves a redstone clock, which comes, as you can see, from extra utilities. So let's make that. I'm going to need 5 pieces of redstone for that. And 4 pieces of smooth stone. So we'll start cooking that up. And in the meantime, get that one redstone torch that we're going to need. Cool. And I have more glass here, so that's good. I was cooking up a little bit more glass while I was building that 9x9. There's my smooth stone. And don't worry, I'll upgrade to a nicer than cobblestone house pretty quickly. Just, you know, I don't really have that much by way of resources. Like, I'm pretty good at cooking things up and making smooth stone, but we're not at that point where I can just, you know, bang out a whole bunch of smooth stone, so I was holding off. All right, so I've got a redstone clock. So basically, anytime you right-click on the faucet that we've seen several times now while using Tinker's Construct, it deploys the liquid that's inside the tank. Are we almost there? We're almost there. But the other option, instead of doing a right-click, you can apply a redstone signal. By the way of a redstone clock or any kind of redstone signal, really. Okay, so what I'm going to do here is place down a chest, probably right, where do I want to put this thing, honestly? I'm not sure. Kind of want it, you know what, I'll put it right here. This is as good a place as any. Yeah, that looks good. And the hopper pointing into it. Cool. So hoppers can pull out from this because the casting basin is basically an inventory. Okay. So the hopper can pull out from it no problem. We've got a bunch of molten glass. I'm going to pour one block of molten glass into the tank. Cool. Once it solidifies and hardens up, it's going to instantly empty out the tank because it's got a hopper underneath it. Ta-da! Where'd it go? Straight into the chest. And we've got our first piece of clear glass. All right, I'm going to place my redstone signal next to it. There we go. Every time it pulses, it kind of like starts and stops. So this guy pulses, I think, once a second, and I don't think it's variable. We will eventually build something that can probably be a little bit more of a control over this thing so that it flows out a little bit quicker. But for now, this will work just fine. Cool, right? Oh yeah, look at that. You know what? I wonder if I actually want to change something up a little bit. I might. I have an idea. Well, Yeah, we'll let this thing go for now. The reason, however, that I'm making this awesome, super cool clear glass is it's the first example, I think, that I have for you of connected textures. Connected textures came around somewhat recently. I want to say maybe back in 1.5. Maybe it exists in 1.4. You know what? I think Zycraft was one of the first ones to have connected textures, and then other people started picking up on it. It's really, really awesome stuff. Let's go see what we can do with it. Basically, connected textures connect the textures between any two blocks that are adjacent to each other. So we can see here that this clear glass, the textures on the corners all connected to each other. So it looks like one giant pane of clear glass. How cool is that, huh? Very cool. So I'm gonna let that thing cook away here. So we're just gonna let it sit. We'll come back later and find a good number of clear glass in there. We'll fill in the rest of the roof. In the meantime, I need a door. And I made an iron door ahead of time because we're playing on hard mode, right? Yeah. Let's actually, I'm thinking I wanna clear out the ground. Yeah, probably. I don't think I should be walking around on grass, you know. Cobblestone's much nicer to walk on, I think. Maybe. I don't know. And then we're going to have to call this new place home. Oh good, it's getting dark out. I'll be able to sleep through the night and move my bed. So we'll get this thing placed, just like so. And in order to get inside, I'm going to use an obsidian pressure plate from the Obsidian Pressure Plates mod. There we go. Obsidian pressure plates only respond to players, okay? They will not respond to enemies or items or anything like that, so feel free to drop whatever items you want on there. They're never gonna respond to it. Only players can open the door. So it's a great one to use for iron doors on hard mode servers because zombies can come hang out on this doorstep all they want. They will not open the door. No enemies will. Cool. All right, let me replace the floor. And I know I just cleared out the obsidian pressure plate I placed. It was there temporarily to demonstrate. See what I mean about loving this whole situation? With the excavator and everything? One thing with the excavator is you can't do, like, fine-tuned controls of, you know, only break one block at a time. But, you know, we'll get to something maybe in the future that can. Alright, now that we've got a nice floor, let me show you what I mean by the efficiency of the 9x9. Alright, I'm going to set it to show me where enemies can spawn. So if I were to place torches up on the wall in this 9x9 pattern, we'll find that it perfectly covers the room. If I had built a 10x10 or anything larger, we would have a spot in the center that was not, you know, darkened. So we would have had to place torches in the center of the room, you know, or it was darkened, I mean, you know, so it wouldn't be lit up. But hey, so far so good. Let me go move my bed so that I have my spawn point set. And then we're going to be in pretty good shape, I think. I'm gonna have to start moving my machines and stuff. Typically when I build, and you know what, I'm bringing this guy too. That should be good. Typically I like to have like my main entryway also be like my bedroom. So it'll be kind of the place where I, you know, hunker down and live. But then we're going to expand on this house, and we're going to build bigger and better things. So bed's going to go there, crafting station can go there, and we'll sleep through this night. Awesome. And now that we're awake, I think I saw a creeper. Ah, he's in the distance. He won't bother me none. How am I doing for clear glass? Oh yeah, we're getting there. There is a faster way to do this, and I'm considering it. Alright, that creeper came out of nowhere. Awesome. Luckily, the smeltery survived. Alright, I'm gonna have to replace all this stuff, of course. I will be back in a moment. Alright guys, I'm just currently working on taking care of recreating what I had here, and I figured, you know what, while I'm at it, why don't I make a faucet, no, seared, alright, mod tinker's construct, what's this thingy called, smeltery drain, okay, that's perfect, that's exactly what I have the resources for, smeltery drain, and seared faucet, awesome. All right, let me do something real quick. I'm gonna replace this back piece here with another smeltery drain, and then I'll hook up my casting basin like so. right, guys, I realize we've already reached the wrapping up point for the episode, but I wanted to do one more thing before we do wrap up. I want to get some molten glass, and I want to set it up so that it automatically pours out of the tank here into this casting basin. Okay, so I'm actually going to break this. I'm going to hook up some fluid ducts. The only problem is that if I enable this fluid duct to constantly pull out of here, anytime I melt anything within the smeltery here, it's going to go directly into the casting basin. That's things like, oh, I don't know, anything, you know, metals and whatnot, what have you. So I want to make sure that only seared glass will get pulled out of this. The nice thing about fluid ducts is there's actually, if you right click on it, there's a filter which can filter out the different types of fluids and prevent certain ones from coming out. Let's show you how it works. First off, I'm going to need a bucket of the fluid that I'm interested in. So I'm going to place down a tank, a buildcraft tank. Oh, that's not what I wanted to have happen. Let's wrench you back up and let this thing fill up again. There it goes. Much better. And then we will break that and let that hook up again. There we are. Much nicer. All right. So I've got the fluid duct, and I'm going to pump out of here like so. We're going to close you off, and then we're going to pull liquids out, and it'll drain right into the tank. Cool. Then I should be able to pull it out with a bucket and get myself a molten glass bucket. Now I have a bucket's worth of molten glass. Perfectly exactly what I wanted. All right, I'm going to place this guy back down and the seared faucet as well. Cool. Over here, I'm going to come over to the interface and I'm going to set it to a whitelist, meaning only these liquids are allowed to be pulled out of this fluid filter. All right, and I'm going to place the bucket of molten glass in there. And if we highlight over it, we should see the tooltip says molten glass. And the redstone signal is going to be set to enabled low, meaning it'll always pull liquids out of this tank unless it receives a redstone signal. Now, if I hit this with a wrench, it should pull molten glass out. The only thing is I need to get some molten glass in there. So why don't I throw some glass in? And, you know, we should see that this will only pull out the molten glass and not anything like iron, for example. All right, so actually, as a good example for that, I might just throw a piece of iron in. Yeah, that sounds like a good plan, or any kind of metal for that matter. Aluminum. That sounds like a good time. I've been meaning to smelt that stuff up anyway. So I'll be back in a minute to show you guys this working. The only last concern that we're going to want to do is this guy. We're going to make sure that we have a chest. I'm thinking right here might be a good spot for it. Where is that chest? Thought I had one. All right, let me go get one. All right, guys, so typically I do like to keep these episodes right around 30 minutes, so try not to get used to the long episodes. It just seems like I'm having so much fun in my single-player world that I just haven't had a chance to wrap up on time yet. But that's going to happen probably pretty soon. We're going to start wrapping up on time, actually. So as you can see here, we've got molten aluminum in here. It's not being drained out over here by my fluid duct, which is awesome. The only thing that's going to be allowed to be drained out by the fluid duct is, you guessed it, molten glass. So once these few pieces of glass here all melt down completely, which should happen any moment, we should start seeing some molten glass show up in the smeltery tank, and then it'll automatically drain out. There it goes. Cool. Molten glass. And over here, we should see this starting to drain. Okay, and it's not. Make a liar out of me, why don't you? I wonder if it's because the molten aluminum is blocking it. Let's get the ingot cast here and drain that molten aluminum in. It might be kind of that the aluminum is at the bottom, so it's preventing the molten glass from getting drained. We're gonna find out if that's the case. Yes, that was the case. Okay, cool. So aluminum did not get drained. Molten glass is getting drained. We've now automated our smeltery such that anytime we put metal in there, it's not going to automatically drain out, but any glass will automatically drain out. Pretty cool, right? All right, for now, though, this is Direwolf20 signing off. Hope you guys have enjoyed this episode, as always, and we'll catch you next time. All right, guys, take it easy.